Hey, welcome to Sunday Encounter again. We are on our last leg of our message series, Make Room for the Supernatural. And our last message today is, how do you activate your supernatural power? You know, talking about supernatural powers, I want to ask you a question first. Have you ever felt tired? Have you ever felt extremely exhausted or stressed out? Maybe you're overwhelmed or you're anxious of the future. You know, as I ask you this question, I am tired. I am exhausted. So I ask the Holy Spirit, God, am I supposed to share this message on how to do you activate your supernatural power when I am tired? You know, running a small church is not easy because you are the building manager. When the things go wrong, you have to go and get the contractors, you have to work the contractors, you have to, you know, take care of the bills, everything else, and then you got to manage the staff, and not only that, you got to plan for the services, you got to plan for the social media, everything, you got to do everything, and I got to go, you know, I got to preach the message, and I got to do counseling, I got to meet people, and then there's so much to do, and when Roland called me a superhero, oh my gosh, I don't think I'm one, you know, it is so challenging, and it's exhausting. So when I asked the Lord, I said, God, I don't think this is the right message for me to speak. And the Holy Spirit asked me this question. He said, can I ask you three questions? I already felt that's what the Holy Spirit asked me. He asked me, are you burned out? I look, no, I'm not burned out. Holy Spirit, that's good. Are you stressed? I said, yes. Good. Huh? Why is stress good? Okay. And the third, he says, are you tired? Yes. Then the Holy Spirit says, that's why you need to preach this message. Because you need to encounter me in a personal way so that you can share to others as well how you overcome being tired through the power of my Spirit. So as I begin to just evaluate this passage from Isaiah 40 verse 31, spoke to me. I mean, and I want to share starting from verse 28. It says here, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they, okay, this is the part that the Spirit begin to even speak into my spirit. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Wow. So this passage begin to just resonate. Let me give you a background of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 1 to 39, it actually talks about God's rebellious people craving worldly security and how God purifies them through judgment. But in Isaiah 40 to 55, which we just started reading Isaiah 40, it talks about God's defeated under worldly dominion. You know, I think we live in a world that we are dominated, you know, wherever we go, the secular world is dominating the Christian world in a sense. Everything we do, we are now afraid to speak up because we felt that people are going to bombard us in different ways. And whatever we speak, we want to be careful. We are not sure whether whatever we say, we go to college, we go to work, we begin to be more like a undercover Christian. And that's why it says worldly dominion. And instead, so God began to see that we are facing this whole circumstances. The world has changed. And instead of God wanting to judge us, He now consoles and comforts his discouraged people. Because we're tired, we are lost in a sense in this world, that, you know, in terms of words, in terms of different issues. But God says he's going to send comfort, and that comfort is the Holy Spirit. You know, when you look at Isaiah 40, it's so powerful, because if you read the whole scriptures, it talks about God wanting us to make, God wants us to make the way for him. In verse 3, it says, a voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. You know, Isaiah 40 is talking about we as sons and children of God. You remember 2 weeks ago I talked about that. We are supposed to prepare and make way for our God. So let's look at this scripture in verse 31. It says, they shall wait. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. You know, the word wait means kavah in Hebrew. Okay? And what does kavah means? It means to have patience. Wow. It's not those waiting where, you know, you bring your girlfriend or wife to shop to the shopping mall, and then she goes into the shop looking at clothes and you're outside there waiting, idling away. That's not the wait God is talking about here. The wait here is an action relational word. It talks about abiding. And I like the other one. Other than patience, other than abiding, other than enduring, it says to expect, to have great expectation while you wait. So it's a bit different. And even in Greek, it means perimeno, which is found in Acts 1, verse 4 to 5. Let me just read the scripture and say, while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, but many days from now. Now, so that Greek word also means to remain, to endure, and to abide. You know, the word wait here is actually a relational word. And if I were to sum up this whole word, the word is a relationship. And in this relationship, you've got to learn to have patience and then abiding with an eager expectation of hope, rest, and trust. You know, I there was a saying, I like this saying. He says, patience is a virtue that carries a lot of W-A-I-T, weight, not W-E-I-G-H-T. Let me read again. Patience is a virtue that carries a lot of weight. You know, Spurgeon says this, everything comes to the man who can wait. It is only a matter of time. Patience behold great wonders in spiritual things. If we watch and wait, we shall see glorious things. So to begin to activate the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit, you need first to wait. The activation is a bit weird, right? Because usually people say, oh, you know, you need to do some actions and all those. But it's an action word that means to wait. It's a bit interesting, right? But in that wait, it has that relational, that trust, that hope. So let me give you an example. You know, the word waiter comes from the word wait. Isn't that interesting? And I know nobody dreams, okay, to be a waiter, but if you are, can just imagine, okay, please, just imagine you are a waiter, but not in Malaysia, but in America, because in America, most of the waiters earn more money from the tips they receive than their actual salary. So some actually, you hear stories of 100 US, 1,000 US, some even give up to 5,000 US tips just by eating maybe a 5 or 10 US dollar burger. People will do that. And why do people give such big tips to a waiter? Because if you are a waiter and if you want to get big tips, you must ask yourself, how do I bring value to my customers and they will see that value I give them is worth tipping me more than what they eat? And it starts with being authentic, right? And relational, because if you go and meet your customer and people cannot feel you are authentic and relational, then they will feel that, hey, you know, why should I tip you? You are just here just wanting a tip, but you don't even treat me. You're not alert. When my coffee finishes, you're not even here. Hey, you know, would you like a top up? You know, you are just really fast and quick because you are anticipating and your expectation. You see, remember the wait, God says that you must wait with great expectation. So you are patiently waiting, and then when you see an opportunity, you go there with great expectation that because of what you do, you are going to be greatly tipped. But, you know, what's interesting is many of us treat God like a waiter. Instead of we waiting on God, or we are God's waiter, we treat God like a waiter. We sit down, we wait and say, God, I'm waiting. Where's my drink? Where's my coffee? Where's the promise that you've given me? You know, where's my job? Where's my girlfriend or boyfriend that I want? Oh, why are you not healing me? Why are you not answering me? Why am I going through this? You know, you sit down and you begin to just wait and asking God the waiter for all the things that you want. God wants you to be a waiter waiting upon Him. When you wait upon Him, you are going to see that God is going to give you nuggets after nuggets and treasures after treasures of things beyond your imagination because you waited on Him with expectation. But not the other way around, because a lot of us tend to make it the other way around. We sit down waiting for God the waiter. I hope you are not that person who treats God as a waiter. And that is why when the Holy Spirit says a helper, you know, what saddens me is the Holy Spirit is a helper to help us, but He is not a domestic worker. Because, you know, today we always use the word helper as a domestic worker. We treat the Holy Spirit like a domestic worker. Likewise, it should be actually the other way around. We are supposed to serve the helper, the Holy Spirit, asking Him, hey, Holy Spirit, what can I do for you? So as we come into a time of worship, I want us to evaluate our lives right now and ask ourselves, God, forgive me if I have made you a waiter. As you worship right now, will you come and place God at the right place? I want to be God's waiter. I want to be the Holy Spirit's waiter. Let's come into His presence right now. I pray that you had a great Holy Spirit moment during worship where you were, you know, humble enough to come to God and say, God, I want to be your waiter. Now, the way to activate the power of the Holy Spirit is to start waiting upon God. As I mentioned, right? That's what the Bible says. So to be God's waiter is by knowing how to serve Him. You know, I know Pastor Catherine last week talked about walking in the Spirit, but I just want to add a few moments of how to activate the Holy Spirit. And to be able to activate the Holy Spirit in your life, I need to remind you this part. You know, there was a story during the Great Depression. Jobs were very, very hard to get. So there was a telegraph company needing somebody as a telegraph operator. So this guy began to say, hey, I know this job and I think I know how to do this job. So he was excited, and the next morning he got up and he got dressed and he went to the telegraph company. As he reached there, he was discouraged. You know why? The queue was like, man, a mile away, so long, and it's like maybe 300 person away from the interviewer. And he was asking himself, should I continue waiting here? So he said, well, I'll just wait for a while and see what's going to happen. And while he was waiting, he heard this sound. And then suddenly, out of nowhere, he just jumped up. I got the job! And everybody's like, 300 people all look at him. Excuse me, you are behind here and you are saying you got the job. Are you crazy? Then he said this. You know, what you are hearing, if you are really listening, there was a Morse code. And the Morse code said, if you can understand this, come inside, you've got the job. Wow. You see, he first, before he could listen, because maybe he has a listening ear, but maybe the other 300 also heard it. But you know, it didn't mean anything to them, not because they were not listening first, but because they don't even know Morse code. Right? So if you have no relationship with the Holy Spirit, how can you activate the power of the Holy Spirit? Because you need to know Him, then you can hear Him, then you can activate the power of the Holy Spirit. So that's the first part I just want to remind you all, even as Pastor Katrina has spoken about it, but I want to remind you that you, as we said, the waiting involves a relationship with a great expectation that God is going to do something for you. Right? So in the scriptures, I love this scripture, it says in Proverbs, it says here, blessed, happy, prosperous to be am I is the man who listened to me, watching daily at my gates. I like this, waiting at my doorsteps. Now, in your waiting, if you hear nothing, probably you either don't know Him or you're not really listening. Now, as I was saying, you need to activate, you know, the power of the Holy Spirit. What does activate mean? The word activate means to be reactive or more reactive, right? Reactive is acting in response to a situation rather than creating or controlling it. So when you go back to the scripture in Isaiah 40:31, it says, but they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Did you know an eagle does not flee from the storm? I'm sure a lot of people have told you this story, right? An eagle will fly into it and will use the wind of the storm to rise higher in a matter of seconds. They use the pressure of the storm to glide higher without having to use their own energy. That is reactive. So if you want to activate the Holy Spirit, you cannot force the Holy Spirit to be activated in your life. It has to be reactive, natural. Just like the eagle, he would just go and see the storm. It's interesting, right? That means, that's why you remember when I shared, when the Holy Spirit asked me, are you stressed or are you stretched? Not stressed, are you stretched? I say yes, and the Holy Spirit said, good. You know why? Because it is when you are stretched, that is when you are facing the storm. And when you are stretched, you must allow, just like the eagle, lift his wings and just head on and let the wind begin to glide you, or let the pressure of the storm to glide you higher. You see, when you are stretched, it is powerful when you allow the Holy Spirit to move in your stretching. But if you don't, then your stretch becomes a stress, and then that's where maybe you fall into depression. Let me continue. So, therefore, the eagle uses the pressure of the storm as a reactive to help him glide higher without having to use their own energy, right? So we must activate our weight. We need to activate our weight and make it reactive. Thus, the strength we use will be renewed. Strength like, you know what's wind turbines? If you go to European countries and all the places, you see these wind turbines, they use the wind, and then they form energy from the wind. The turbines will then create energy. You know, these wind turbines, what we call our natural energy, basically, it just regenerate. It's called reusable energy. You know, when I look at that, the wind turbines is exactly what God wants you to have, renewable energy that does not need to continue to just slog and, you know, like putting petrol. Every time you know petrol, you got to go to the petrol station and put it again, petrol. You don't need to, because it's reusable, it's not only, it's renewable strength. And that's what God wants you to have. He wants you to like be the wind turbines, you know, where the Holy Spirit will begin to just energize you. Every time when you are low, you will pick up again, because just like a solar, you know, the solar panel, when the sun goes down, of course, it will conserve energy. But once the energy goes off, but when the sun comes back, it gets its energy again. God wants to always renew you with new strength. But why sometimes you do not activate? You're not activated. You know, so as I've been preaching this message, I realized now why I was tired. Why the Holy Spirit was not activated in my life when I was tired. And the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. He said, now you know, right? Because when I was preaching, or I was putting in, I call it the preaching SIM card. You know, let me tell you about SIM card, you know. If you are in Malaysia, you have the same SIM card everywhere you go. But let's say now you go to the States, you will change your SIM card and put in a different SIM card. Or if you go to Japan or any other countries, you will begin to change SIM cards, right? Now, similarly, I realize Christians, we do not maintain one SIM card. When we go to college or school, we have a different SIM card. Our SIM card is supposed to be empowered or activate the Holy Spirit SIM card. Just put it in, everywhere I go, I'm supposed to be activated by the Holy Spirit. But when you go to school, you take away the Holy Spirit SIM card and you put in school SIM card. Don't talk about Jesus. Don't share about Jesus. Don't share about my life. There's no power. Just go there and study and go back. And if I have friends, my friends will not know I'm a Christian. Whatever not, I am just going to be a normal person who people do not know what my religion is, because I don't want people to know that I have a relationship with Jesus. Or you go to work, same thing. People know as you as a nice guy, but nobody knows who you believe in because you put in your work card, work SIM card. Everywhere you go, you change SIM card. You go with your friends, you change your SIM card again. Everyone do not know who you are, because your Holy Spirit SIM card is only for when I come to church. Or when I meet Christians, my SIM card goes in and we will talk about God. But after that, no. Nothing about God. You know, you're putting one leg in the world, you're putting one leg in the church or in God, and then you say, God, where are you? Where are you? I'm waiting on you. What happened? Why didn't you come and rescue me? Or why you didn't answer me? And God is saying, excuse me. Everywhere you go, you put in a different SIM card. You don't put in the Holy Spirit SIM card. And you expect me to do great things for you when you don't even think or even have a relationship with me outside the church. You don't even dare to share your love for me. Or do you really love me? You are scared. You feel that there's no power. Your expectation of the Holy Spirit is almost nil. Zero when you are out there, when you're in schools, college, or work, or with your friends, it's zilt, it's zero. Only is found in the church. So let me ask you, would you activate the Holy Spirit, I call it a SIM card, everywhere you go? Will you be God's waiter, waiting upon Him all the time to give you the next, for lack of a word, mission, what you're called to do? You do not segregate and have many different SIM cards, but only one Holy Spirit SIM card that travels everywhere with you, and you are going to communicate with the Holy Spirit everywhere, no matter where you are. And that is why, as I looked at my own life, when I was preaching, I was guilty. I really came to God. I said, God, you know, I'm supposed to know this. I'm a Christian, I'm a pastor. But sometimes I put in a different card a different SIM card. When I watch TV, maybe I put a different SIM card. When I like this, you know, when I preach, maybe I'm putting in, okay, I just need to know what I need to talk about, and as long as I can look good and people understand what I'm talking about, then that's the, as long as people get the message. So I begin to realize that, hey, you know, that's why I'm tired. Because I have been guilty. I am, you know, guilty as charged for not realizing that everything I do involves waiting upon the Holy Spirit. And when I wait upon Him, I am going to see wonders, miracles, signs and wonders. I want to add a bonus. You know, in my experience, to activate the Holy Spirit, you need to have a booster. I call it a booster. Or I call it, you know, turbocharged. You know, you need a turbocharger. And it's a free gift that God wants to give you. You know, in my experience, that turbocharger or that gift can help you better relate with the Holy Spirit, help you listen, your ears are more open, and help you live in the Holy Spirit. You are fully activated. You know, your phone bar is always full. The activation is always full, and then your signal is always full because of this gift, that booster, and that is called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says in Acts 2, verse 1 to 4, it says, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You know, today, you know, wherever you are, you can ask God, Lord, I want the baptism of the Holy Spirit. As we end, again, I don't know where you are, but my question to you is, are you, number one, God's waiter? Because to activate the Holy Spirit, you need to be God's waiter, waiting upon Him for the next mission, serving Him, you know. Everything is, okay, you do this. Okay, God, I will do it. When you serve Him with that understanding that it will activate the power of the Holy Spirit, then you got it. But the second thing you need to realize is, are you putting different SIM cards into your life? So you only activate the Holy Spirit in church and you expect God to activate it in your whole life. It does not work that way, my friends. You have to maintain that SIM card all the way. Do not change your SIM card. Then you will see the Holy Spirit activated in your life. And the third, go get the baptism of the Holy Spirit, because the baptism of the Holy Spirit is free. And it opens your senses. It opens in places where you don't even realize, and you'll be blown away with the free gift that God wants to give you. So let us just come into the presence of God. God, thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your word. Thank you that, Lord, I now, Lord, know that, God, I just need to wait upon you with patience, with great expectation and relational kind of waiting, not waiting idly or idling away, Lord. Lord, I just pray, O God, as I wait upon you, Lord, like a God waiter, God, that you are going to reveal many great and mighty things, Lord, because your word says, as we wait upon you, you're going to renew our strength, like the wind turbines, Lord, that continue to just renew its strength. God, I just pray that, God, I will not change SIM cards. I will have that SIM card of the Holy Spirit everywhere I go, God. And that connection will always be full bar, because with the Holy Spirit SIM card, it will never even drop one bar. It's always full, Lord. So, Lord, I pray, oh God, that, Lord, I will not change SIM card, and I will not even consider, God, to do any different SIM cards, because those SIM cards will never give me or will never activate me with power, God. Instead, it will actually drain me. So, Lord, I just pray right now, God, if I have not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Lord, I want the baptism of the Holy Spirit in my life. And for those of you here who do not know Jesus, and you say, hey, you know, this is really cool. This is something that is different. And I want to try, I want to try your God, because your God seems to be able to, yeah, empower me. Give me renewable strength. You know, just like the eagle who flies and do not need to use his strength. That's what Jesus wants to give you. If you are that person, will you pray with me? God, I pray. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross, because of the cross, Lord, you have given me freedom. And you sent your Holy Spirit so that I can be activated with power, renewable strength. So, Lord, I come before you, forgive my sins, and accept you as my personal Lord and Savior. And as I commune with you, Lord, I just pray that, God, you are going, your Holy Spirit will continue to work in my life. Lord, continue to help me see that I need to wait upon you. In Jesus' name, amen.